At the core of the human experience is our very vast and complex social world, where we live together and we have to interact every day and even meet new people, like maybe tonight. And to manage these very different and sometimes difficult relationships, we have a very efficient and successful tool, our language. Now, our language did not appear magically out of nowhere, and we're also not the only highly social species on this planet. Chimpanzees also live in very large groups and face many of the similar social situations and challenges like we do. They have to build friendships with each other, they have to take care of their families, and they want to succeed in their own group. And because they are our closest living relatives, when we study differences and similarities with them, we can better understand our own evolution and how we came to be who we are today. Chimpanzees, like these in the photos that I took in Uganda, interact a lot socially. Here on the left, we see the alpha male of a community staring into the eyes of another male who was the former alpha male of the same community. These two share a very strong bond because they've spent so much time together, being allies and grooming each other to strengthen their bond, which is the activity that they're gonna do right after I took this photo. On the other photo, very similar but also quite different situation. This is another community of chimpanzees where we have an alpha male on one side and the former alpha male on the other side. As you can already tell by the body posture, their relationship is not the same. These two have been fighting and being direct competitors for many months just before I took this photo. Finally, the younger one took over, but these two still need to invest time to build a strong relationship and potentially become allies one day. Chimpanzees face many of these interactions and social situations. And to navigate this, they communicate using a series of different gestures and sounds. Here on the left, during a moment of tension between the males who were trying to compete to get access to a very popular female in the group, we see a male reaching out from a tree with his hand trying to shake the foot of another chimpanzee. And this is very similar to our own handshake. He was trying to signal to the other that he's on his side, he's not gonna harm him, and he's not gonna stop him probably from getting the female that day. On the other image, we see a completely different situation. Here is a much more relaxed moment. We have a mother who is playing with her new infant, just a few weeks old. And she's doing what we call a kiss gesture. Again, very similar to ours, but here she's gently biting on the belly of the infant. And she's developing their bond by playing, taking care of her, and again, spending good time together. And you can see the reaction of the young infant. Now, the gestures that these animals use are so similar to ours. And in fact, it's astonishing that when we compare them with the gestures that our own babies, human babies, use before they start to speak, we find that most of them match. They are basically the same in form. And this is not just something that we researchers can understand by studying chimpanzees. It's quite intuitive. I think you all can also see how they look alike and they might mean the same thing. And this clear parallel and similarity between the interactions and the communication signals that we use is even more clear when we look at accidental interactions that happen between us, in particular researchers in this case, and chimpanzees. So for example, one day as I was following this male in the forest to study his behavior, I did not pay so much attention because I was looking at my phone, not on social media, but I was collecting data. And I approached him too much. I got too close to him. He immediately looked back at me, staring at me straight. He stomped with his foot on the floor, on the ground. He grabbed a tiny tree that was between us and he started shaking it and looking at me. And I, without even really thinking about it, I just immediately took a few steps back and gave him space. Again, so intuitively, without wondering what he might meant, I did exactly what he wanted, because then he was relaxed, friends like before, and this is the same gesture he would have used with another chimpanzee that was maybe bothering him. And if we reverse the roles, on one of my first days in the forest, I learned from my field assistant who was assisting me and teaching me that whenever a male is doing a display of dominance, like in this photo, where you can see that they're puffed, they want to look bigger, and they're charging at me, I should just stand still, not move. I should not show that I'm scared or that I am subordinate to this male. And obviously I had to trust him on his word, but this was very important because the male that day did charge at me directly by running towards me. And until the last second, I was extremely excited and my heart was racing, but he just slightly changed the direction at the end to just miss me. And he almost brushed my legs with his hair. He understood that with my body posture, I called out his bluff. And from then on, he did not tease me again like this. Now, the similarities that we share are not just with gestures, but also with the sounds that we use to communicate with each other. Chimpanzees produce loud calls to communicate with each other in the forest when they don't see each other or they're very far apart. And these sounds can be heard up to a kilometer away in a dense forest, imagine. And I learned over time by listening to these calls that actually, yeah, this was the same call type that all of them were using, but each of them had a unique sound signature. They all sounded slightly different. And enough for me to learn that, this sound is this chimpanzee. And that's how I could find, for example, the chimpanzee that I really wanted to study that day, by just listening to them. Or maybe to find them again when I lost track of them because I'm not as good as them to move in the forest. And here we see a male calling on the right, doing this characteristic call that they do, because he's been left behind by his group and he's wondering where everyone went and he's looking for an answer. And on the right, we see a group of chimpanzees who were just resting, chilling, and grooming each other. And they just heard a male calling from afar, and immediately everyone just joins in a chorus, and they reply to him, telling him, "We're here." And that's how they keep in touch. And if we reverse the roles again here, when we go in the forest as researchers, there's multiple teams of us following different groups or individuals of chimpanzees. And to find each other, we also use sounds. We produce a hoot sound by blowing between our hands. And Nora, here in the image with her son, is a very clever chimpanzee because whenever she was with us alone and she could not find her own chimpanzees because they were being silent in the forest, she learned that if she heard a hoot after we would hoot to find the humans in the forest, she would go in that direction because she knew that, well, if the humans are in the forest, they're probably here to do their job and follow us. And I mean, very cleverly, she succeeded many times to then find back her group. Even though I'm not sure they wanted to be found, but that's another question. Now, as you can see, there's many similarities in the way we interact or we use signals to communicate with each other. And nowadays, with the very powerful new technologies like artificial intelligence that we develop, we maybe think that finally we have the right tool to fully understand what they mean when they talk or when they communicate to each other, to break the language barrier between us and them, and potentially even have a conversation with them. And despite how intuitive, smart, quick, and how well these new AI understand us or reply to us in a very human-like way, they still rely at the core on the knowledge that we, humans, accumulated over many, many years. And so, the best tool that we still have to decode and understand chimpanzee communication, but even animal communication, is still right here, actually. It's in our head. And this is because we're so good at perceiving what happens around us, to observe and pick up even complex behaviors when we give enough time to observe this. And in part, it helps with chimpanzees that we're so close biologically, but also, as you've seen, that the social situations we engage with are actually very similar. I do find it a bit ironic that we believe that artificial intelligence is suddenly going to allow us to talk to animals, when at the same time, we're slowly realizing that it's changing so much the way with which we interact with each other. And it's making our communication also more distant, more detached, and in a way, less genuine. And I think it's important we realize we're also a little bit losing touch with each other, a certain connection. And this connection that we're losing is also with the real world out there, the world where the chimpanzee lives, and where some groups of chimpanzees are endangered or disappearing without us even realizing. Now, tonight you learned, hopefully you listened, that chimpanzees use loud calls to communicate in the forest when they're afar, like when they're distant and they don't see each other, because ultimately they want to meet up again in person and spend time and bond, as we've seen. And so no matter how advanced or complex our communication devices might become one day, it would still be nice if sometimes we use them to meet up and still interact in person. And this is important because sharing thoughts, sharing feelings, and sharing experiences is what really made us uniquely intelligent and successful as a species. We transitioned from some type of individual intelligence to a collective one where we learn from each other, where we would share our diverse knowledge to expand and go beyond whatever each of us individually was able to do. Just think about computers. We all use them and we benefit from them, but no one in this room would be able to build one from scratch and make it work. And so now, at the peak of our innovation and technology, I think we're facing potentially another transition, one where there's another new intelligence in town, one we created, and it might make us question what's going to be the role of our own in the future, in a future where a world becomes more virtual and potentially less grounded. As we externalize, in a way, intelligence, our own creativity, our own communication, and our own ability to solve problems will inevitably change. They might be enhanced or replaced, but this is obviously up to us. And so now, more than ever, we should be mindful and reflect on how our intelligence evolved and made us who we are today, how it accompanied our lives so far, and which role we wanted to have in our future interactions, but in general in our future societies. Do we want to be more like spectators and users, or have a more active participation? So finally, just like it's always been at the core of the human experience, we should communicate with each other, share our thoughts, to find answers and solutions together, a bit like we tried to do tonight here.